My name is Martin Schringer, and I will talk about how the new PBT chemicals that are now on the SIN list were identified and assessed. My co-worker in this project is Carla Ing, my colleague at ETH. We work at the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology in Zurich. Carla is a chemical engineer, I'm a chemist, and our field of research is methods for chemical hazard and risk assessment. So, PBT chemicals, also here, the slides should look different, but I think you can still see what the points will be. PBT chemicals are chemicals that are persistent, bioaccumulative, and toxic, and they have all of these three properties in combination. Persistent means that the chemicals have time, so they can travel, they can circulate in the environment, they can reach remote regions, they can build up concentrations everywhere in the world. Bioaccumulative means that they form higher concentrations in the tissue of organisms than in the surrounding environment. And toxic means that they exert toxic effects already at low concentrations. Now, the problem is that if they have these three properties in combination, there is no safe level for these chemicals, because imagine there is a very low concentration of the chemical somewhere in the southern Pacific Ocean. Because the chemicals are so persistent and long-lived, they have time to build up higher concentrations, increasingly higher concentrations in organisms, and at some point in time, the concentration will be high enough to cause toxic effects, although the initial concentration in the water was very low. And this effect is important also, especially for organisms that are higher up in the trophic chain or in trophic food web, and this is indicated here by the polar bear. So typical or archetypal PBT chemicals are, for example, DDT or PCBs, polychlorinated biphenyls, but there are many more. And an important question, still a research question in a way, is how many are they and what is the chemical diversity of these PBT chemicals? And we have done quite some work in our group on this question. So, for example, we performed a large-scale screening study. We investigated a set of 95,000 chemicals and screen them for potential PBT chemicals. This is a paper in ES&T, and we found a number of about 3,000 potential PBT chemicals in this set of 95,000 chemicals. And I'm happy to share this with you if you're interested in this study. We also screened the same set of 95,000 chemicals for potential POPs, persistent organic pollutants. And that's the second paper where we present these results, and we found a number of several hundred potential persistent organic pollutants in this set of 95,000 chemicals. And we also, again, this is not visible here, there should be a third line now saying that we also investigated in much more detail a smaller set of chemicals. These were 36 new or emerging brominated flame retardants, and we investigated the PBT properties of these chemicals in much more detail, as you can see from the title of this paper. So for the purpose of today, how do we define and identify PBT chemicals? This is the starting point here is REACH, and next 13 of REACH contains the definition, the legally binding definition of PBT chemicals in the EU, because it sets out, it defines the criteria for P and B and T. So for P, it is half-lives, degradation half-lives that have to if a chemical has a degradation half-life, for example, in soil or sediment that's greater than 120 days, it's called P. For B, it's the so-called BCF, the bioconcentration factor. This is the ratio of the concentration of the chemical in the tissue of an organism, for example, a fish, and the surrounding water. And if this ratio is higher than 2,000, then the chemical is called B. The BCF only includes transfer of the chemical from the water to the fish via gill uptake or dermal uptake, but not via food. And for T, it is a so-called NOAC. This is the no observed effect concentration in a chronic test. And if this is below 0.01 milligrams per liter, the chemical is called toxic. So this is the core set. This is how the criteria were defined initially. But then it turned out that many of these data are not really readily available, and more data also need to be used to come to a final conclusion. And therefore, other data are also listed in Annex 13 now, and in addition to specific additional data that are listed, also the statement is made here that other information, provided that its suitability and reliability can be reasonably demonstrated, can also be used. And what we did, for example, we included also BAFs. BAFs are bioaccumulation factors from field studies. Bioaccumulation factors are also defined as the ratio of the concentration in the tissue of the organism and the surrounding environment. But here, the uptake is also, or includes also, uptake via food, in addition to uptake via skin and gills. And we also use TMFs. These are trophic magnification factors that describe the increase in the concentration of a chemical along the different levels of a food web. So this defines the data that you would have like to have to make a PBT decision. But the first and often disappointing experience is when you look for these data for a given chemical, you may not find them. There are not really many measured data for these properties. So we had to use estimation tools, and it's a common situation in this kind of assessment that somebody has to use estimation tools to get the data. And then what's also important is in the cases where you could find measured data, they were often just not right. And this was a very disappointing experience. And also including the ECHA database, I have to say that also the ECHA database was not a reliable source of data. There were many highly inaccurate data points in the ECHA database. Perhaps this is interesting to Gerd, I don't know. So what happens is that these measurement errors are not a surprise because these properties are so difficult to measure. For example, a very long half-life, you need a very long test duration. You have to control the conditions in the experiment for a long time, and this is very expensive in the first place and not easy to do, and therefore there are just not many of these measured half-lives available. Another important quantity is the KOW. This is the octanol water partition coefficient. This is the ratio of the concentration of the chemical in octanol and water. These are two solvents, they are not miscible. And if a chemical has a high KOW, this means it has a very low solubility in water compared to the solubility in the octanol. And octanol is used as a surrogate for lipids. So if a chemical has a high KOW, it often also has a high BCF, or a high bioaccumulation potential. Because the solubility in the water is so low, if the KOW is high, again, this is very difficult to measure. And therefore, many of the KOW measurements are not correct. What's also difficult to measure is slow uptake. And these PBT chemicals often have a very slow uptake. And this again means we have to have a long test duration. We have to have control the test conditions for the full duration of the test. And that's again at least expensive and not easy. Same thing for low effect concentrations. LC50 is the lethal concentration for 50% of the test organisms. And EC50 is the effect concentration for 50% of the test organisms. And if these are very low, which means the chemicals are very toxic, again, this is difficult to measure. So what we found was that many of the KOWs and the BCF values that we found in the databases were much too low, including, again, the ECHA database, where there are many cases of inaccurate BCFs and KOW values. In the case of toxicity, we found that the toxicity data were not useful either. In many cases, only nominal concentrations were reported, so people reported just the amount of chemical they put in the test system at the beginning, for example, 100 milligrams per liter, but they didn't report the actual concentration that was dissolved in the water phase. Or toxicity tests were performed with a solid material, and the solid material has a much lower solubility than the so-called subcooled liquid material, which is the form in which the chemical is present in the environment, and therefore a test performed with the solid material does not show the environmentally relevant toxicity of a chemical. In addition to these laboratory test data, we also used experimental data from field measurements. So we also looked up data from field studies that demonstrated the presence of the chemicals in organisms, in environmental media all over the world, and also the accumulation in the food chain. The next type of data that we had to use because there were so many data gaps in the measured data were estimated data. So we used a range of estimation tools. Many of them are established, and people who work in the field may know them. For example, there's EpiSuite, which is a suite of different estimation tools which can be downloaded from the US EPA website. And this suite includes, for example, BioWin, which we used for half-life estimates, degradation half-life estimates, KOWWin, and BCF, BAF, and ECOSAR. So we used these tools. We also used individual QSARs. These are quantitative structure activity relationships for BCF and the LC50, the toxicity concentration, and also others. And we used as many tools as possible in comparison, in combination, to see what the range of the estimated data was, so that we could get an idea of the uncertainty of these data points. Then, overall, we then put together what we could find from laboratory tests, what we could find from field data, and from estimated data. And we used a weight of evidence approach. We investigated and scrutinized the data carefully, and then made our recommendation. I would like just at the end to address two types of chemicals that were important and were included in the end by ChemSec in the list. One group is chemicals like these ones here, which are actually not PBT chemicals themselves, but they are precursors of PBT chemicals. You see these structures here. These are polyfluoroalkyl phosphate diesters, so there are two chains on the phosphoric acid in the middle. And what happens here is that these structures can hydrolyze, as we call this, so the chains go off from the phosphoric acid in the middle, and then these groups here, are oxidized, and in the end, these chemicals form PFOA, perfluorooctanoic acid, and also PFOS, perfluorooctansulfonic acid. And these ones are PBT or POP chemicals, and therefore these ones are the sources of these acknowledged PBTs and POP chemicals, and therefore we think they also qualify for inclusion in the SIN list. That's one important decision that we made, and the other one was that we investigated in much detail chemicals that have a very high KOW, because in the scientific field here, in environmental chemistry and toxicology, it is often assumed that chemicals with a high KOW do not have a high bioconcentration factor because they are too bulky, too big to really be taken up by the organisms, and that they are not so toxic because they're just not soluble enough to exert toxic effect. But it has now been established in the literature, and you can see this from the references down here. This is not new. This was published quite some years ago already, that these assumptions were derived from artifacts in the experiments. So it is not correct to make these assumptions. And as a matter of fact, chemicals with a high or very high KOW are toxic, and they do have also a high bioaccumulation potential. This can be seen in well-designed laboratory tests. So there are laboratory tests that show these properties, the high toxicity and high BCF of these chemicals. But they can also be seen from field data. So what we also were able to find was field data where people just took, for example, fish in China and measured the chemicals in the tissue of the fish and measured the chemical level in the water and compared these two and again calculated the ratio of the two concentrations and found that the concentration in the fish was, for example, a million times higher. This value here, a 6, this is the log of the bioaccumulation factor, and if the log is 6, this is a factor of a million between the concentration in the tissue and the water. So these bulky, high KOW chemicals all have these very high bioaccumulation factors, so we have evidence from field data that they do bioaccumulate. And also down here, there is a trophic magnification factor here. It also shows that this chemical magnifies in the food chain.
Fairly briefly now, if you would.
Here we are.
Ah! So, we must be psychic.
So, Carla and I would like to thank our co-workers here, Andreas and Oria, who collected lots of data for this work. And I thank you very much for your attention.